The soldier, not the poet, has given us freedom of speech. Father Dennis Edward O'Brien. In Norse mythology, the word einherjar, which means army of one man, refers to a group of select warriors whose courage and bravery on the battlefield earned them a place in the Grand Hall of Odin, the Valhalla. Each of these warriors could decimate entire armies with just one swing of their weapons. However, as the saying goes, truth can be stranger than fiction, and throughout the history of mankind, many warriors have accomplished feats that exceed those of even the greatest mythological heroes. We've heard about the extraordinary achievements of military leaders like Alexander the Great, Julius Caesar, and Napoleon, the masterminds who often get credit for their stunning victories. But sometimes, only one out of 100,000 soldiers is responsible for turning the tide in favor of his army, all by himself. You're about to meet the 10 deadliest, most lethal, and most dangerous warriors in the history of humanity. Tlahuicole is remembered as a legendary warrior who became an important leader in the resistance against the Aztec Empire during the late 15th century. He is decorated as the greatest champion of the Tlaxcalans. The first writings that mention him refer to two things. One was his impressive combat capacity, both at a strategic level and his performance on the battlefield. And the second is his immense strength, which is described as superhuman and superior to that of any warrior of that time. He used a macuahuitl so large and heavy that only he could use it fluently thanks to his genetics, blessed by the gods. As Tlahuicole participated in military campaigns defending Tlaxcala's sovereignty, rumors of his skill and power spread beyond its borders. His notable success in the Aztec Flower War included multiple victories against Mexica forces, with his casualty record growing after each battle. During one confrontation, after the death of Moctezuma II's son, the Aztecs sent a powerful army that captured Tlahuicole. While the Aztecs typically sacrificed captives to show dominance, Emperor Moctezuma recognized Tlahuicole's potential and chose not to waste it. Moctezuma offered his enemy freedom, but Tlahuicole's warrior mindset dictated that defeat would come on the battlefield, so he declined the offer. This response shocked Moctezuma, and so he decided to appoint him as the leader of one of his armies which attempted to invade the Purépecha territory, located in the current state of Michoacán. In his new command, Tlahuicole fought great battles, defeating countless enemies. For this, he was offered his freedom once again, but he declined it for the second time. Tlahuicole assured Moctezuma that he wanted to die like every warrior, in sacrifice. For this reason, the emperor gave him the chance to participate in the Temalacatl ritual, which was a ritual battle similar to those of the Roman gladiators. Such confrontations were carried out in honor of Xiptotec, the deity of life, death, and resurrection of the Mexica culture. Tlahuicole faced the battle without hesitation. Tied at the waist to a circular stone, he was given a macahuitl and a chimali to defend himself. He fought several warriors from the Mexica hierarchy and managed to seriously wound more than 20 and kill 8 of them. However, he suffered injuries in the battle, causing him to be defeated by the Mexica. As the ritual marked, after his defeat, Tlahuicole was sacrificed and his heart was removed in honor of Xiptotec. Richard the Lionheart, born in 1157, was known for his ability as a warrior and military leader, earning him legendary status in medieval Europe. He was renowned for his exceptional martial skills. Tall in stature and great physical strength, Richard was a master swordsman and a formidable hand-to-hand combatant. He was known for his talent with the lance, excelling in jousting and mounted combat, where his ability to strike accurately was among the best of the time. Richard was also highly trained in using the crossbow, a weapon that required both strength and precision. He had a keen sense of timing and strategy, and often led charges and broke through enemy lines with his direct involvement. Richard's reputation as a warrior was cemented during the Third Crusade. He led his troops into battle, demonstrating fearless leadership. One of his most notable victories was the Battle of Arsuf in 1191, where Richard's strategic brilliance allowed the Crusaders to defeat Saladin's forces despite being vastly outnumbered. Richard commanded approximately 12,000 men, and Saladin's forces exceeded 40,000 soldiers. His ability to maintain discipline and execute complex battlefield maneuvers under pressure made him highly respected among his men and feared by his enemies. Beyond just being an expert fighter, Richard was also a great tactician. After a protracted and difficult struggle, the Lionheart helped to seize Acre successfully by using the geography and force of his men to his advantage. His deft use of naval force and siege tactics proved his thorough knowledge of warfare. Richard had an unrivaled reputation as a warrior king, yet he spent little time in England due to his devotion to the Crusades, despite his military prowess. His sense of honor and gallantry was well known. Recognized, respected, and to some extent feared, Richard the Lionheart is the ideal representation of a warrior king capable of protecting his people until his very last breath. Xiahudun was a strong commander who worked for the fabled warlord Cao Cao in China around the end of the Eastern Han Dynasty and the beginning of the Three Kingdoms period. Xiahudun rose to prominence as one of Cao Cao's most feared and trusted commanders because of his everlasting allegiance, amazing bravery, and exceptional combat ability. Xiahudun was a formidable opponent on the battlefield because of his skill set with the sword and spear. He was considered a terror for any rival who dared to challenge his strength and accuracy. He could sever opposing lines with such violence that both his enemies and allies would never forget it. Xiahudun's strategic approach to warfare was as remarkable as his combat experience, making him an indispensable asset to Cao Cao's military campaigns. Xiahudun always employed the technique of ambush and feint to deceive his foes and beat them at their games. He understood very well the aspects of surprise and time, and therefore used it to shock the opponent. His tactics not only involved shock action, but space for the opportunity for a decisive, timely strike. Good military strategy is all about saving forces and simultaneously causing maximum loss to the enemy. This method enabled him to accomplish just that. In one of the biggest battles of the Three Kingdoms period, the Battle of Guandu, Xiahudun played a pivotal role in securing Cao Cao's victory over Yuan Shao. His strategic planning and leadership were key to the success of the campaign. He focused on disrupting the enemy's supply lines and morale, rather than engaging in direct, large-scale confrontations. This tactic weakened Yuan Shao's forces over time, leading to their eventual defeat. His most legendary feat occurred in the heat of battle when an arrow pierced his eye. In an astonishing display of determination and bravery, he tore the arrow and shattered eye from his face and, according to legend, swallowed it. This act earned him the nickname One-Eyed Warrior and catapulted him into history as a warrior of relentless courage. William Marshall is often hailed as the greatest knight in history, and rightly so. He was born around 1147 in England. He rose from relatively humble beginnings to become one of the most powerful and respected figures in medieval Europe. Marshall's early career was defined by his exceptional skill in tournaments, which were the proving grounds for knights, where he remained undefeated, winning countless tournaments that gave him a record of over 500 knights defeated by his sword. His swordsmanship and tactical intelligence set him apart, and he was always described as someone with a unique ability for combat, the perfect prototype of how a knight should fight, which ended up making him a legend in his own time. He was rarely touched by enemy steel in 1v1 engagements, and in between competitions, he was also a skilled jouster with a precise lance technique. Serving four English kings, Henry II, Richard the Lionheart, John, and Henry III, was Marshall's true test of combat. Among his most notable actions were leadership during conflicts with France and the defense of the kingdom in the First Barons' War. In 1217, Marshall led the royal forces to victory at the Battle of Lincoln, decisively defeating the rebel barons and their French allies and securing the future of the English crown despite his advanced age. Records praising him as the knight with the highest honor attest to his constant dedication to the code of chivalry, his loyalty to it, and his aptitude for navigating the convoluted political environment of medieval England. One of William Marshall's greatest achievements was his longevity. He led the lines until he was over 70 years old, and this fact served as an inspiration for many fictitious figures in books, stories, and movies. Hannibal Barca, born in 247 BC in Carthage, was one of history's most brilliant military strategists, earning him the title Father of Strategy. He was the son of the Carthaginian general Hamilcar Barca and grew up amid a fierce desire to challenge Rome, which had defeated Carthage in the First Punic War. Hannibal's entire life was marked by this mission, and he became Rome's most feared enemy during the Second Punic War. Hannibal's most daring and famous feat was his crossing of the Alps in 218 BC, leading an army of around 50,000 soldiers, 9,000 cavalry and 37 war elephants. He undertook a perilous journey across treacherous mountainous terrain to invade Italy. This maneuver was both a logistical challenge and a brilliant strategy, as it bypassed Roman defenses and took the war directly onto Roman soil. The Romans were not prepared for an invasion from this direction, which showed Hannibal's ability to think beyond conventional strategies. Once in Italy, Hannibal demonstrated unmatched tactical genius. His most notable victory came at the Battle of Cannae in 216 BC, where he inflicted one of the worst defeats in Roman history. With a force far smaller than the Roman army, Hannibal employed a double envelopment tactic, surrounding the Romans and destroying almost the entire 86,000-man army. This battle is often cited as one of the greatest tactical masterpieces in military history and is still studied in military academies around the world. Hannibal was feared not only for his success on the battlefield, but also for his psychological warfare. He understood how to demoralize his enemies, turning Rome's allies against them and causing a sense of terror. Despite his ultimate defeat, Hannibal's strategies influenced military strategy for centuries. Roman generals and others throughout history studied his tactics and recognized him as the father of strategy. Shaka Zulu, born in 1787, was the founder of the Zulu Kingdom and one of the most feared military leaders in African history. He revolutionized warfare in southern Africa with innovative tactics, rigorous discipline, and efficiency. Shaka transformed the Zulu army from a loosely organized group of clansmen into a highly effective military force. He introduced the ikhlwa, a short stabbing spear, replacing the traditional throwing spears that forced warriors to fight in hand-to-hand combat. This change increased the lethality of Zulu forces by emphasizing hand-to-hand combat, which Shaka excelled at. Shaka also implemented the bullhorn formation, a tactical maneuver in which the Zulu army would surround and crush its enemies. This tactic was devastatingly effective, allowing his forces to overwhelm numerically superior enemies. Under Shaka's command, the Zulu army grew to number 50,000 disciplined warriors, trained in rigorous drill and intense physical endurance. Shaka's combat skills were legendary. Standing over 6 feet tall and possessing immense strength, he was a formidable warrior. He led from the front, directly engaging in battle, inspiring his men and terrifying his enemies. His reputation was built on his brutality. It is said that there was no stronger warrior than him in the field and that he ended any confrontation quickly. During his reign from 1816 to 1828, Shaka expanded Zulu territory dramatically, conquering neighboring tribes and integrating them into his growing empire. By the time of his death, the Zulu kingdom had expanded its influence to more than 250,000 square kilometers and was a dominant force in southern Africa. Shaka Zulu's military innovations and fierce command made him one of the most feared leaders in history. His legacy as a brilliant strategist and warrior transformed the political landscape of Africa. Simo Heha, known as the White Death, was a Finnish sniper who became a legendary figure during the Winter War between Finland and the Soviet Union, which lasted from 1939 to 1940. Born in 1905, Heha was a farmer and hunter before the war, which honed his marksmanship and survival skills in the harsh Finnish wilderness. During the Winter War, Heha used his exceptional shooting skills to devastating effect against the Soviet invaders. He primarily used a Finnish M28-30 rifle, a variant of the Mosin Nagant, and a Suomi KP-31 submachine gun. Remarkably, Heha preferred to use iron sights rather than a scope, as it allowed him to maintain a lower profile and avoid glare from the sun that could reveal his position. Heha is credited with over 500 confirmed kills during the 100-day conflict, making him the deadliest sniper in history. His kill record was achieved in the sub-zero temperatures of the Finnish winter, often as low as minus 40 degrees Celsius, where he would spend hours, even days, in the snow, camouflaged and waiting for his targets. His ability to remain completely still and invisible in the snow made him a living nightmare for the Soviets. Heha's impact on Soviet morale was significant, earning him the nickname the White Death from his enemies. He was so feared that the Soviets made several attempts to eliminate him, including deploying counter-snipers and artillery strikes. Still, he survived them all until March 1940, when he was severely wounded by an explosive bullet that disfigured his face. Despite his injuries, Heha recovered and lived until 2002, leaving behind a legacy as one of the most skilled and lethal snipers in military history. When asked what he felt about killing an enemy soldier, he said, "The recoil." Lu Bu, born in 161 AD, was one of the most formidable and feared warriors of the late Eastern Han Dynasty during the Three Kingdoms period in China. Nicknamed the Flying General for his unparalleled martial prowess and agility in battle, Lu Bu's reputation as a nearly invincible fighter has become legendary. Lu Bu's combat skills were described as practically inhuman. He was a master of all types of weapons and techniques of the time, from horseback archery and hand-to-hand combat to the complex handling of his weapon known as the Fangtian Huaji, a halberd-like spear that required great control to use. He became renowned for his strength, as it was often said that he needed no weapons other than his hands to be just as lethal, which, combined with his agility and exceptional skill in mounted combat, made him a one-man army on the battlefield. Lu Bu's most famous act, and what would define him as a warrior, was his betrayal of the warlord Ding Yuan, whom he served as an adopted son. Lu Bu was convinced by the powerful warlord Dong Zhuo to kill Ding Yuan, which he did, and took Dong Zhuo as his new adoptive father. Lu Bu is perhaps best known for his role in the chaos that followed Dong Zhuo's tyrannical rule. He eventually turned on Dong Zhuo and killed him in a dramatic coup. But this act led to him being ostracized and hunted down by other warlords. Despite being outnumbered in many battles, Lu Bu's great combat ability allowed him to hold off and defeat multiple opponents, often single-handedly. One of the most famous legends surrounding Lu Bu is the story of him fighting 500 soldiers alone. This story, though exaggerated, is perfect for understanding why Lu Bu possessed all the qualities to make the soldiers of the time think he was a superhuman. Lu Bu's most iconic battle was at Hulao Pass, where he faced three of the greatest warriors of the time, Guan Yu, Zhang Fei, and Liu Bei. Although outnumbered, Lu Bu fought all of them simultaneously, defeating them. Despite his godlike abilities, Lu Bu was very impulsive, reckless, and irrational, and combined with his tendency to betray his allies, these traits led to his death. He was captured by the warlord Cao Cao in 198 AD and executed. Yet Lu Bu went down in history thanks to his ferocity, often cited as the greatest warrior of his time. Lucius Siccius Dentatus, often called the Roman Achilles, is considered one of the greatest soldiers in Roman history. Born in the early 5th century BC, he served the Roman Republic with distinction and earned a legendary reputation for his unmatched combat skills and extraordinary bravery. He comes from plebeian origins and climbed the steps of status in Rome thanks to his military performance. Dentatus is said to have fought in over 120 battles during his lifetime, a staggering figure even by Roman military standards. He was wounded more than 45 times in different battles and survived each and every one. He took part in nearly every major conflict of his day, including the wars against the Aequi, the Volsci, and the Sabines. His battlefield experience made him one of Rome's most experienced and respected warriors. Dentatus was also renowned for his combat skills. He supposedly engaged in single combat against 8 different champions and defeated them all, further solidifying his reputation as a formidable fighter. His record of killing enemies in combat ranges between 3 and 600 casualties. Throughout his career, Dentatus was awarded 18 different decorations for his valor and service. These honors included 14 civic crowns, which were awarded for saving the lives of his fellow citizens in battle, a testament to his courage and selflessness. In addition, he received 83 gold torques, 160 armillae, and 26 different crowns, including the prestigious obsidian and mural crowns, for his numerous victories and acts of heroism. Finally, he was awarded the Corona Graminea, the highest military decoration of classical Rome. Dentatus was renowned for his tenacious support of the rights of the plebeians, or regular inhabitants of Rome, besides his military prowess. Political rivals, who feared his influence, arranged his assassination due to his outspoken nature and widespread popularity. He died at the age of 60. But even in the circumstances he was in, he managed to wound 15 of the 25 soldiers who were tasked with finishing him off. With so many military honors to his name, Lucius Siccius Dentatus, dubbed the Roman Achilles, is arguably the most decorated warrior in ancient history. Before we continue with number one, let's see some honorable mentions. Miyamoto Musashi, the most legendary swordsman of all time, fought more than 60 duels to the death during his life and never lost a single fight. He could have easily entered this top, but we already have a video on this channel covering his life, fights, and philosophy. Feel free to check it out after this video. King Leonidas of Sparta, another unmissable warrior who led the 300 Spartans against the Persian army during the Battle of Thermopylae, of whom we also have an extensive video about his legacy. Lyudmila Pavlichenko, the terror of the Nazis, was an incredible sniper who fought in the ranks of the Red Army in World War II with more than 300 confirmed casualties. Ivar the Boneless, the most tenacious and fierce of Ragnar Lothbrok's sons, led the pagan army and fought against European forces. And Maharana Pratap, the fierce Rajput king of Mewar, was a master of warfare and a symbol of defiance against the Mughal Empire. Legend has it that he was so strong, he reportedly split a Mughal soldier and his horse in half with one strike during one battle. Khalid ibn al-Walid, known as the Sword of Allah, is considered one of the greatest military commanders in history, being compared by some to other military geniuses such as Alexander the Great, Julius Caesar, or Genghis Khan. Born around 592 AD in Mecca, Khalid was a member of the Quraysh tribe and initially opposed the Prophet Muhammad. However, after converting to Islam in 629 AD, he quickly became the most formidable warrior and strategist ever seen. Khalid's military career is marked by an unbroken record of victories in over 100 battles, including major conflicts against the Byzantine and Sasanian empires. Khalid's most famous victory came at the Battle of Yarmouk in 636 AD, where he led a force of approximately 30,000 Muslims against a Byzantine army of 100,000. His innovative use of mobile cavalry units, strategic feints, and knowledge of the terrain allowed him to defeat the Byzantines, securing Muslim control over the Levant. Another significant achievement was his conquest of Iraq during the Ridda Wars and subsequent campaigns against the Sassanid Empire. During the Battle of Walaja, Khalid employed a double envelopment tactic, annihilating a much larger Sassanid force and demonstrating his mastery of battlefield tactics. Khalid was not only a brilliant strategist, but also an individual fighter on par with the best, like many others on this list. He was known for his outstanding bravery in every aspect, his adaptability in combat, and the way he exploited the fast-paced fighting style that characterized the Muslims. He was both the best commander and the best warrior. On top of that, he had a peculiar ability to inspire his allies, as it was an honor for anyone to be able to fight alongside the sword of Allah. Despite his unparalleled success, Khalid was eventually removed from command by Caliph Umar, not because of failure, but because of concerns about his growing popularity. But beyond that, it is rare to find not only a military genius of his caliber, but also such an exceptional fighter. Khalid ibn al-Walid finally died on March 22, 642 AD in Homs, Syria, at around 50, after retiring from military life and going down in history as the greatest warrior of all time. If you enjoyed this video, please subscribe to the channel and turn on notifications so you don't miss what's coming next. Thank you all for watching. If there's a historical figure you'd like to see featured next, or if you have any thoughts to share, feel free to leave a comment below. I'll see you in the next video.